Hello and welcome to Creating New Audiences for Dance, presented by Shantha Ratii Initiative SRI. I'm Chaku Vadakev, coming to you from a rather hot and sultry Sunday afternoon in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Selamat datang, welcome to this forum. Now, dance is one of the three main branches of the performing arts. The other two are, of course, theatre and music. And all three of them are usually performed in a venue, a designated venue, and before an audience. So an audience is a critical part of a performance, but audiences can be fickle, elusive, and in today's age, they are completely spoilt for choice as to what to do with their spare time. Saul Hurok, the great Russian-American impresario, famously said, "When people don't want to come, nothing will stop them." So how do you make them want to come to the theater to watch you or turn on their screens to see you and to choose your show instead of Spotify or Netflix? These challenges have always been there and have been drastically, even catastrophically amplified with the arrival of the coronavirus. In much of the world, theaters and performance venues are closed and have been closed for much of this last year. Performances are usually now viewed, like this forum, virtually. So it's about getting bums on seats and about eyeballs on screens. If one chooses to watch dance, the reward can be great. The great American dancer choreographer Agnes DeMille said, to paraphrase, "To watch dancers is to see something that is larger, more beautiful, more powerful than yourself. It's glory on earth, and it's yours for the taking." We will hear from panelists on this topic, and then we will look at questions from viewers. So I see some viewers coming in. Selamat siang and welcome. And you feel free to post your questions in the comment section on your YouTube screen, and I will try and get to them during the discussion section if time permits. We have about 75 minutes or an hour 15 minutes for this session. We have a truly phenomenal group of leaders in the world of dance, brought together by Shantha Ratii to discuss this important and timely discussion. We'll both look at issues that have been long-standing, pre-COVID, and hopefully as vaccines kick in, we are going back to something like the old normal, but also urgent, pressing concerns today during the pandemic of how to simply survive and ride out the pandemic and not go the way of companies like Cirque du Soleil, who've had to file for bankruptcy in Canada. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's meet our panelists. From Kuala Lumpur, we have dancer, choreographer extraordinaire, the chairman of Sutra Foundation, Padma Shri Dr. Ramli Ibrahim.
Hi, hi everyone.
Hello, Ramli. Thank you for joining us. Lovely. All the way in Russia, we have the director of the Jawaharlal Nehru Cultural Center in Moscow, dancer turned distinguished arts consultant and impresario, Usha R.K.
Namaskar.
Namaskar. Usha, lovely to see you.
The opportunity to share my thoughts.
Namaskar. Yes. Namaskar. Lovely to see you, Usha. And that's a beautiful green sari. And we have, beaming in from even further away, on that island that's firmly socially distant from the rest of Europe, from London, England, co-founder and producer of the world-famous Akram Khan Company, and also CEO and creative director of China House London, Farooq Chowdhury, OBE.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome from a very foggy London. It's Dickensian weather, I'm afraid. So really happy to join you this morning, afternoon, okay. Early evening.
I think it's two extremes. Kuala Lumpur is boiling hot. And well, we're in two corners of the world. Lovely to see you. Thank you so much for joining us, Farooq. And ladies and gentlemen, last but not least, the woman whose brainwave this forum has been, from an island too, but one that's at the crossroads of the world. She's supremely skilled in multiple dance forms, especially Kuchipudi. She aims to unite people through dance. Please welcome Artistic Director of Shantha Ratii Initiatives, Shantha Ratii. Hello, Shantha.
Hello, hello to everybody. Welcome to all of those people who have joined us. I want to, right at the outset, thank our renowned panelists, Dr. Ramli Ibrahim, Farooq Chowdhury, Usha RK, our celebrated moderator, Jacko Padir, and the superman behind this, giving us technical support, Rejun. Thank you all very much, indeed. I have been always been interested in the matter of audiences. Initially, of course, like all dancers, we are enthused by the compliments, by the applause and the energies they bring, etc. But with time, I started questioning, what is it that they liked and what is it they did not like, which is very important to know. And later became conscious of the need to develop new audiences. This is in the 90s, probably accelerated by the fact that I had just moved from New York to Mumbai. And lo and behold, I find that Kuchipudi, which was the style that I was primarily practicing then, was grossly underrepresented. So the need to create new audiences and to share the beauty and breadth of the form. Alongside this, I started to add, to make it interesting for people, literary works from different parts of India. So different languages, presenting it in different ways thematically, and importantly, explaining to the audience what I was going to do. And I found that that entry point for them was very helpful for them to follow the dance and appreciate it more. It is, of course, interesting for us to note that in the Indian thought tradition, audiences are referred to as sa-hridaya, meaning of the same heart, of the same mind, of the same intent. So we have here the dancer and the spectator, and they are supposed to be aligned emotionally. When that is the case, so then the question is, what is our offering to them? What is it that we are offering that could pique the interest of audiences and also to maintain it? What is the rasanubhavam that we are offering them? So that brings us to this concept of rasa, which is a very complex and deep subject, but suffice to say that the very purpose of art is to create rasa, that ah moment that we all experience, whether we are aware of it or not. And so this problem of diminishing audiences, this problem of aging audiences is a reality. I dare say it is a shared concern in the fraternity across the globe to varying degrees. So the sooner we address it, the better. So hence this forum. And we'd love for you to send in your thoughts and questions as well, because this is only a beginning of the discussion we hope to establish. Let us then start with the thoughts and ideas and experiences of our eminent panelist. Over to you, Checo.
Thank you so much, Shantha. And that was beautifully put. From my heart to yours, from the dancer to the audience, and that's a lovely concept. So now that we've got a little bit of an overview, shall we hear from each of our panelists? We'll hear from each of our panelists, and then we'll go into a discussion session, and we can take questions. So do post your questions in the comment section on your YouTube screen. Let's start with Dato' Ramli Ibrahim. He is a man who's been declared as a living heritage by the government of Malaysia and a living treasure by UNESCO. Cambodia is Angkor Wat, Indonesia has Borobudur, and Malaysia has Ramli Ibrahim. And he's definitely the best preserved of all three monuments, I think. And I think nobody would dispute that. So he's been hailed internationally for taking the Indian classical dance form Odissi to great heights. He's also an accomplished He's also accomplished in ballet, modern dance, and Bharatanatyam. He's chairman of the wonderful Sutra Foundation, which apart from staging dazzling dance shows, also puts on art exhibitions, seminars, and culinary extravaganzas. He's been honored with the Fulbright Distinguished Artist Award from the USA, the Sangeet Nathak and Padma Shri Awards by the President of India, and the title Dato by the King of Malaysia. Now, before we hear from him, let's get a taste of Ramli and Sutra. We'll see a little clip, which you'll see part of their recent performance in the virtual arts festival Gerak Angin, two presentations in India showcasing Odissi classical dance, and onto contemporary dance with the Malaysian Philharmonic Orchestra. There you have it, the monumentally talented Ramli Ibrahim and the Sutra Foundation. Welcome, Ramli. Thank you so much for joining us. So let me ask first, or shall we? I thought we could start with just looking at the challenges with regard to getting audiences before the pandemic. You know, what are some of the challenges that you faced and how have you addressed them?
Right. Before the pandemic, which means that's quite a stretch, Chaco, you know, those were the very exciting time when dancing was a privilege. Later on, when I came back to Malaysia, not only do I have to be a dancer, the kind of larger than life heightened experience that everyone expected of you, but also eventually I have to be a very good teacher to be able to cultivate, groom a bunch of really very well trained dancers, first in Bharatanatyam and then in Odissi. And so you have to, the two mutually exclusive thing of being a dancer, a teacher, and then also a choreographer, because you have to find the good work for the dancer to dance in. So these are the three areas. You know, of course, people see you as a dancer and not really see you as a teacher, and the amount of time and effort and sacrifice and passion that you give as a teacher and then as a choreographer of dancers. And I did that in both contemporary modern works and in Indian classical dance. And I do define modernity, the kind of innovation can happen also within tradition. And so the over-intellectualism of what you want out of the audience, that relationship is expected. You know, you just got to dance well, you got to produce good work, you have to produce the great dances that everyone's going to love. So I think the audience comes then because of that. And at that time, you don't really realize all that. And of course, later on, the idea of publicity, marketing had to come. And now the paradigm has shifted even further. You have the competition with, as you say, Netflix. During the pandemic, we have to, thank God, we managed to do this incredible work, virtual arts festival called Gerak Angin.
Yes.
Featured 17 dance companies, groups covering theater, music, dance, and of course, I had to collaborate with Masakini and Surprise Ventures. And on top of that, we have to be well subsidized by Ministry of Tourism, Arts and Culture. So there you are. You have to be consistently creative. And to a certain extent, feel what the audience want with the work. I have always, there is no criteria as such. It's just got to have a good work, there was a time when having a dance an audience of 800 is considered not enough, you know. And later on, Sutra not just have one day season, but we have 2 days, 3 days, and then eventually a week season. So we become a kind of a mainstream also in Malaysia, performing in a big theater like Istana Budaya, or not as big in KL Pact and all that. It's just that we have to have very good performance. And this, what happened, Chako, also is that we just don't concentrate in Kuala Lumpur. Having worked so much for the production, then we have to tour it. And I guess Sutra is one of those companies that toured all over Malaysia from Kangar, north of the Malay Peninsula, right up, right down to Kota Kinabalu. So we formed a base of very strong audience, especially in Indian classical dance. But we did also tour some contemporary modern works.
Okay, so Ramli, so basically the work speaks for itself. If you do really good, spectacular work, the audience will come. But it's also, you know, you have to wear so many different hats, right? It's not correct. Just focusing on the performance. You do have to get funding. You have to do outreach. And I know you've done outreach to poorer communities to get them dancing. And I think that would also bring in new audiences. And I think one of the important things is educating audiences. It's not enough to just educate dancers and train, but audiences also need to be exposed to dance, to learn to love it.
So what Shantha has talked about, the Srihadaya or the Rasikas, has also come from the audience. And fortunately, I think the Indian audience is one of the most Rasika prone. I think they are very passionate. You can find during Navaratri music and dance is part of that general activities of the community. So that's wonderful. But you have countries such as Indonesia or Sweden, where both education, the Ministry of Education and Culture, is one group, one under one roof. So this is the cultivation, the grooming of young people right from the beginning is also very, very important, because we are not looking at just Indian dance. We are also looking at other forms, dance, theater, music, all come together, And I think Chako, the situation in Singapore as a city state is a bit different from Malaysia and maybe a bit different to London or Moscow.
Of course.
There have been a great tradition of theatre tradition, whereas in Malaysia there is also community activities happening also in Indian temples or in, say, in Bali, in the folk situation of the villages and things like that, or in Java, for example, and in India. So I think you have to look at certain area. But I must tell you that someone who is also practicing Indian classical dance, I did not want to be culturally colonized by Indian artists. So we were ready to even Odissi form our own parampara of Malaysian Odissi dancers, but very much paying homage to the to the source, which is, say, Odisha or Bhubaneswar. So though I have very strong contact with the eye of the storm of creativity in India, of course, and you know, to tell you the truth, in Indonesia also. This happens as sutra travels all over the world.
I'm going to sort of stop you there so that we can hear from the other panelists and then we can do a discussion. But they're just wonderful topics, and you know, your breadth of your experience and travels are obviously fantastic. And you know, I can see from the comments we've got people coming in from Athens and Indonesia and of course Russia and Malaysia as well, that I can see from the comments. Let's move on to our next distinguished panelist, who is Usha RK. We're honored to have her join us all the way from Moscow. She's the director of the Jawaharlal Nehru Cultural Center there. She's an expert in the dance forms of Bharatanatyam and Kuchipudi, as well as in Carnatic music. Usha is a pioneer as an arts organizer, as well as a formidable impresario. She staged mammoth festivals like Swarna Sankhya and Raga Thala, as well as Nritya Dara with 175 dancers. She's worked with top dancers in India and musicians, as well as film legends like Amitabh Bachchan and Lata Mangeshkar. We are thrilled to have you join us here from Russia. Usha, thank you for joining us.
Ramkatha takes you briefly into some of the facets of Rama's relationships. Concise delineations and excerpts, episodes strung together, is Ramkatha. A solo thematic presentation is a challenge for any dancer, having to portray multiple characters, switching from one to the other instantly, and keeping the essence of each character intact, and displaying all this with verve is not an easy task. And Satyanarayan Raju has attempted to take us on a journey into the life and times and relationships of Rama. Some of the relationships and characters that have been included today begin with, of course, Kausalya the mother, Dasharatha the father, his devotees Hanuman, Guha, and of course Shabari, and then concluding with his prime enemy, which is Ravana.
Pararam Kalatmaka Parameshwararam Shuddha Brahma Parat Pararam Kalatmaka Parameshwararam Shasoma Rama Tapana Vamsha Soma Sunama Vipula Khala Viloma Rama Tapana Vamsha Soma.
That was beautiful, Usha. Thank you for sharing that. I think we'd all love to see more, but we want to hear from you. And so, Usha, let's jump straight in. What's it been like this past year in Russia? I think that's a place that most Malaysians don't know well. And how has the pandemic affected you and your work at the cultural center?
At the outset, I'd like to quickly thank Shantha, my dear friend, and all my fellow panelists for giving me this wonderful opportunity. to share some thoughts of mine. We have been going through a very tough time the last 10 months, and we have not been able to do the things that we always did with a lot of joy. When I speak about, you know, creating new audiences, Russia was not that much of a challenge in terms of creating new audiences, because Russia, from the USSR times, loved India, loved Indian dance, loved Indian films. It has a huge audience here. As much as, you know, the great dancers are, you know, superstars here, like Yamini ji and Sonal ji, and all these great artists have come here, M.S. Subbalakshmi, Ravi Shankar ji, Amjad Ali Khan saab, all of them are pretty well known here. And of course, the great Raj Kapoor. So there was so much of an audience for Indian art, and they love our arts over here. So it was not a challenge as such, but I'm going to just quickly go back to my experiences from India so that I can bring it to context. See, primarily when we look at audiences, if you look at traditional audiences, most of the traditional audiences, whether you look at from the times of the temples and the courts, etc., they were all highly initiated audiences. People who came to the temple knew the songs of the gods, they knew what was being performed, and they really enjoyed it, and it was a part of their social life. Similarly, when it was in the courts also, I think all initiated people were sitting in the courts of the kings, and they were highly knowledgeable. So you always had audiences that were initiated. But then suddenly, when we moved out from these kind of congregations onto a proscenium stage, we were wondering what kind of people are going to come to our theatres, to our audience, who's going to be our audience now. And then newer people started coming in. These were primarily posted on stages by groups, social groups, family groups, who started putting these sabhas and trusts and organizations together to appreciate what culture we have. So new audiences started coming in, but then it was not primarily those who only were initiated. There were also people who were not uninitiated, who started coming to see what was going on the stage. And that was the time when content had to move. Content had to be redesigned, realigned, re-looked at, reinvented, as I would call it, so that the stage can then accept what was being done in, you know, in the precincts of a small temple or inside the court, when in every Varnam, if you look at the Bharatanatyam items, they would do the first line three times, because it would be to the king and then to the right and to the left, so that the ministers and the, you know, the rest of the court saw it. So the entire choreography started changing, you know, and then the time limit started coming down. People wouldn't sit for such a long time, like in the temple for 3-4 hours. They would sit only for an hour, 2 hours. So from there, the Varnam from 45 minutes became 30 minutes. And then again, as we started making it more finer and finer, today we've reached a level where we can't see a Varnam for more than 20 minutes. So the entire style and the form and the formats have actually seen a kind of, finer aspects have come out, and more neater ways and, trying to bring it to the audiences in its best form, because greater minds are thinking and more modern minds are thinking, and the times are changing. So we've actually looked at a range of audiences, and today's audience, as I said, always look for something with great finesse and look at it from a very time perspective. They look at the stage being created in a different way. So from a temple where we just had some flowers hung at the back or at the side, suddenly we are seeing these beautiful stages being decorated with pillars and, you know, all kinds of props, and the whole look of it, the packaging has changed. I'm going to mention here from my own marketing, experiences from my other, sort of role which I played in life, was I want to take the example of the Lux soap. You know, so it started off with actresses like Nargis, and then, you know, Kamini Kaushal and Vahida Rehman and what have you, and then slowly moved on to the Rekhas and the, you know, Hema Malini, and then Sridevi, and then today from Kareena and Karishma, etc., it's come up to Alia Bhatt, and then now the latest heroines, all Katrina, everybody have modeled for it. So the same soap, keeping the core of the soap same, that if you use Lux, you feel like a heroine. that has remained, but the heroines have changed and they all look different. The costumes have changed, the look has changed, the communication has changed, the places of shoot have changed, but the soap has remained the same. The core strength of the soap, they never moved that. And in between, they tried to incorporate another look. They called it Lux Supreme. They had Shah Rukh Khan model with Rekha, Hema Malini and all the legends. So you look at the way it was inclusive in thought. It moved along with the times. It gave a different perspective of even bringing a male into the picture to say that if you are good enough and if you look like a heroine, you will even be attracted by a Shah Rukh Khan. So all these things, look at a product. I mean, look at the product, how it has moved in times. Today we have the most fine looking, fabulous packaging, the most pretty young girl right out there speaking about the same soap, but the content and the form never changed. They kept the soap, the content of the soap and the mixture of the soap never changed. It always remained the same. So today if you look at Indian arts, the form, the formats, they don't change. We repackage them and we present them in a manner that today's audiences will be able to appreciate it. Today's audiences will relate to it. What is dance and music? Like she said, Sahridaya and Rasika. The word Rasika means the aha moment when they are having a rapport with us. Only then do they appreciate what we are doing on the stage. How can we not connect with them? So all arts have to be relatable. Unless the audience, whoever comes, whatever age group, maybe 15-year-old or 60-year-old, but unless he or she relates to what the person on stage is doing, there's going to be no rapport, and then there is no rasa, and there is no rasanubhava going on over there. That whole give and take is happening because they've connected with us. And that those moments, which she says, which Shantha says as aha moments, are the moments, the wow moments, when you actually feel, oh God, what was that? For that oh God moment to happen, and from there on, the audience is inside your palm. So Yamini ji said to me very nicely one day when she was describing how she did the Krishna Shabdam, to which when she said Swami Rara, a Sardar ji got up from the audience and walked up to the stage. He said, Aapne bulaya aur hum chale aaye. So this experience when Yamini ji said to me, I asked her, I said, what is in your mind in the side wing before going onto the stage? What do you think about the audience? What are you going to do there for Swami Rara? She said, my mind only says one thing, Usha. She says, Yamini, go there and get them all, kill them. So that is the thought of a star dancer who's going to go on the stage and just sit there and say, Swami Rara, come here. Then that is the wow moment. And from there on, the audience is sitting at the edge of their seat. I don't think anybody ever even breathed when she danced on the stage. I mean, they were so like there, you know. So
Usha, if I could interrupt you, how can you get them to come into that stage? So once they've come to the auditorium, then you've got the audience and then it's the performance. But how do you make them want to come? You know, going back to our quotation from South Europe.
The three very important things, which I think is, one is to be able to market it or package it in a manner that today's audiences will be interested in coming to it. So if I'm going to think of it, like they always say, you know, classical arts are for fuddy-duddy look and all that, that won't work today. So you have to bring it to in a manner that they will appreciate it, the manner in which they'll get interested even to come and have a taste of what that is. Second is the content itself has to be worked in a manner. It could be traditional content. I, you know, by nature work only with traditional content, but even that has to be brought in a manner that the audience will actually connect with it. That is the second part. And of course, the third part, which is the most important thing, is consistency of appearance. If you are not going to bring that dancer on the stage multiple times till the day that he or she is completely recognized by everybody, till then, consistently, you have to keep on. Why do people buy Colgate toothpaste? Because it comes 25 times on television from morning to night. So if you,
but it's also something that's good, right? People enjoy using it and it tastes good and so on.
So unless you keep at it, you know, and consistently present it again and again, you will not be able to make people remember that. So these three things are very important. Package it well, you connect the content in a manner that they will appreciate it, and of course, consistently keep presenting them.
Thank you, Usha. And that was fascinating, and marketing and consistency seem to be the overriding themes. Let's move on to our next panelist, and that is Farooq Chowdhury. He's the co-founder and producer of Up and Come Company, considered one of the top dance companies in the world. It's won multiple awards, of course, in the UK, but also in Germany, USA, Canada, Australia. Farooq has been appointed Tate Artist Trustee for the Iconic Gallery. He's CEO and creative artist of China House Arts, and he's produced for the English National Ballet. He's a consultant for Goldsmiths University, and he founded Sky Blue Productions to support emerging artists. We are honored to have you here on our panel, Farooq. Welcome. Now, before we hear from Farooq, let's see a little bit of the dance that Farooq has been behind. First, we're going to see iconic Chinese dancer Yang Liping in Rite of Spring, then Akram Khan's latest production, Outwitting the Devil, and then Farooq's directing debut, Butterfly Lovers. That was wonderful. That was a little taste of Farooq's work with Akram Khan Company and other artists, and including his directing debut. Farooq, you're in strict lockdown right now in the UK, I understand. So no shows at all. And I think that's been like that for much of the year. But have you been able to find audiences nevertheless during the pandemic?
We have, Chaco. I mean, we've at AKC, we've developed a kind of a whole year of really interesting digital content. And I think the first reaction, the knee-jerk reaction when the lockdown came into place, that everyone just wanted to transmit their previous shows to the digital world. And we stopped at Akram Khan. We thought about how can we make that a more meaningful experience? Because I go back to this idea that every great piece of art has to start with something very personal, with something that you stand on before you even share it with the public. So we took stock and we thought, let's create digital content that expressed our values, that expressed some of our concerns, and kind of, and not just work, but the things that, you know, like, so we had the initial idea, we had these series of stories called Stories of Hope. Then we created this project called Animal Kingdom, where we invited people around the world to create their own animal and share it with everyone else. And then we did this beautiful project, the Silent Burn Project, where we addressed, not only we showed clips of our process, but we also demonstrated our values through our commitment to otherness and, you know, marginalization, representation, religious questions. So it's been quite a busy year. I mean, we've lost 303 shows and counting.
Wow.
So it's been a huge challenge. But you know, on the question of audience, and before I go there, I was just wanted to, you know, it was one of the interesting things about moving from a producer to a director. As a producer, it was always like, how do I, you know, keep one eye on the art and one eye on the money? But now, yeah, as a director, I've realized I need a very, very warm heart and an extremely cold eye. So it also applies to the relationship with an audience in a way. And I think what I'm very conscious of the fact is to move away from the transactional nature of this engagement, this relationship, you know, what we affectionately call an audience member a bum on seats, or now call an eyeball on a screen. I think I'm always very aware that the audience is an essential part of the creative ecosystem. They actually complete the work for us, you know, when we put it in stage, they allow us to step back and understand what we do. So I don't think we know it till the audience has seen it. And I think part of the messaging that we need to make the audience realize is not just that them buying a ticket, they are actually part of that creative cog. And but in saying that, I think it's really essential not to start with them in your mind when you create a piece of work. Because I go back to this idea that, you know, every piece of work in my, especially if you're trying to do something quite experimental with what we're doing at Akram Khan, starts from a place which is personal. Because I, you know, it's that great phrase that's said quite often these days, that which is most personal is most universal. So starting from a place that really that matters to you and then being proud enough to get to the point you want to share that with the audience. So we have to give them more credit. And also we have to understand that they are very diverse, these audiences. You know, we're not, you know, particularly in dance, let's face it, it's not massive. It's not like pop concerts or Netflix. So, you know, our existing audiences also need to be taken care of. We need to, you know, like Ramli said, we need to make sure that the work is constantly innovating, engages with them, it challenges them. But most importantly, I believe we should not be telling the audience what to think. That is absolutely devastating to our art form. We need to create space for them to imagine. And then ultimately, you know, when I think we've succeeded with a piece of work is when someone says to us, you know what? Your story is my story. And that's what we're trying to do. And so I think we then have to take care of the way that we use the language in marketing and stuff, because sometimes it's a little, particularly with the young audiences, some of the language is prohibitive. You know, it stops them coming because it's almost self-reflective rather than speaking in a language that kind of addresses the way the world and young generations particularly are seeing themselves and the world in which they live in. Now, that doesn't mean faking it, you know what I'm saying? It means us taking much greater care about the way that we express what we want to share with the audience. Because, you know, ultimately, again, what we want is a curious audience. We want an audience that we don't want to tell what to think. We want to create a space for them to imagine that experience and for it to become meaningful for them.
So, but at the same time, it's got to be accessible, right? I think that's...
I think, yes, it's got to be accessible, but not at stake, not, you know, not at the cost of saying what you want to say. And there is a risk in our business. You know, we cannot take the risk away. Risk is absolutely essential for progress. If we are playing pandering to the audience, and don't get me wrong, I love the audience. We need them, as I've just said. And, you know, if we take the risk out of the equation, how are we going to get progress? How are we going to get new people to come in? How are we going to get new people to kind of reimagine the world in which they see? Because art isn't just about reaffirming what people know. It's allowing them to see things differently. So that's a critical part of that. And that's how we're going to bring people in. And let's not fool ourselves. It's about money. Because every week when, you know, the stadiums were open in the UK, 400,000 people were going to football games spending £100 a ticket. You know, my teenage daughter spends £100 a ticket to go and see these Korean pop groups. There's no issue of money. It's about relevance. And it's about finding a doorway and a manner of engagement that allows them to appreciate the way that, you know, to understand, you know, what I'm saying, not understand. It's creating a gateway.
Okay. And what's it been like with the lockdown? Are you able to continue rehearsals and creating new works? I know Malaysian Maven Koo is rehearsal director with Akram Khan Company, right?
Yeah, I mean, we've been able to rehearse, which is great, you know, because we need to be creative still. And in many ways, that has allowed us to also think about, you know, I mean, the positive thing about the pandemic is reflection. So all of us, particularly here, and, you know, we're thinking about how can we recalibrate, you know, our offer, our artistic offer as we come out of the lockdown. And, you know, there are issues in the UK, not just to do with pandemic. We also have Brexit on our toes, you know, which is causing a whole bunch of problems. But there's a bigger
issue. You're touring, right? Yeah.
Absolutely. And we are a touring company. We basically do 70%, 72% of our revenue comes from touring. We do about 150 shows a year, right? And I actually once calculated, if we count the output we've done over the last 20 years, we've done one show every 3 days nonstop for 20 years, which is a phenomenal amount of work. But that can't happen because there's another big issue we all have to address, and that's the issue of climate. Because that's a big thing now, particularly for touring companies. How do we now get our work where now the new generation are very conscious, particularly of the kind of carbon footprints, the things that touring companies are doing, and the kind of that damage it does to the environment. So this is another consideration that we have to take forward.
Okay. Thank you, Farouk. That's a really new concept or a new aspect of performance, climate change and your carbon footprint. And that definitely is part of the new normal that we have to deal with, not just the virus.
Can I just add, Chaco, just one last thing, please, before you move on. I think we must never forget that the audience also go to a live experience to be with other audience members. It's a ritualistic collective experience where people go to be with others as much as they go to see the work. And that's something we also have to take care of, because you know, I know that one of the things I'm experiencing is I'm not watching a lot of digital work. And as beautiful as it is, it almost escapes my mind by Friday if I've watched it on Monday. But if I watched the live experience, I still remember it 20 years later. It stays within me. And I think the reason is because the depth of the experience is enhanced by me sharing it with 1,000 people at the same time.
Mm. Absolutely. And it's a direct connection with the performer and the artist when you're in the same room. You know, even, I mean, now at least we're looking at each other and talking to each other, but it's a different just performing to a blank space or to a little camera, and it's just not the same. Thank you, Farouk. And let me move on to the creator of this forum, Shantha Ratii, hailed as the Indian dance icon in Singapore. She's one of the foremost Kuchipudi danseuses today, performed all over India and other parts of the world. She's trained in other Indian classical forms, including, very unusually for a woman, in Kathakali and in the martial art form of Kerala, Kalaripayat. If Ramli is a living heritage, Shantha has been described as a Venus come to life when she dances. The skills extend to poetry, flamenco, calligraphy, kibana. She aims to unite people through dance and through cross-cultural and multidisciplinary presentations through Shantha Ratii initiatives that she founded. She rewarded the title Natya Kala Nipuna and the gold medal in Singapore and the title Kala Shiromani in India. Thank you, Shantha, for inviting me to moderate this forum of yours and for letting me to rub virtual shoulders with you and these other giants of the dance world. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's see Shantha in action in a little clip.
Dum dum nam nam ta ta di di dum dum nam.
there you have it, a little taste of Shantha's work showcasing classical Indian dance forms like Kuchipudi, Bharatanatyam, Kathakali, as examples, as well as examples of cross-cultural and multidisciplinary shows to unite communities and art forms. Shantha, Singapore is a city-state, so there is only a limited pool to draw from for audiences. Would that be part of the problem in limited or dwindling audiences for dance, do you think?
Oh yes, it certainly is. Like when I came to Singapore 10 years ago, it was a different landscape than our cultural landscape here when I left Singapore. So I've had to adapt to that because here Bharatanatyam is the form that is most popular and well known, and the audience have an appetite for it. So when you bring in something like Kuchipudi, it is difficult to get audiences because they think, because it's so similar in technique with Bharatanatyam, it doesn't sort of arouse so much interest. So I have had to find ways of bringing in Kuchipudi along with Bharatanatyam and Kathakali and all of that, as you've seen in some of the clips. But going back, rewinding, I'd like to say that my first experience of this was when I moved from New York to Mumbai in the 90s. And I became acutely aware that the youth of Mumbai, this is almost similar to what my experience I'm having in Singapore now, were completely not familiar with their own culture. Because I suspect it's because of the avalanche of television stations that had suddenly come into their drawing rooms. So I set up a project called Indian Rainbow, which I used to take to institutions like IIM and colleges and Rotary clubs and Lions clubs, just to ignite the interest of those people, starting from there so that I could proceed to the younger generation. And based on the kind of response I got, I got spurred on to do more work. Similarly, I discovered that there was such a lacuna of material in print as well as in film on the Asian dance theatres. Here, I'm not looking only at Indian dance forms. The Asian dance theatres, primarily Chinese opera, Kathakali, and the Japanese forms of Kabuki and No Theatre. So I made a documentary film celebrating the similarities between these Asian forms because I felt that people know very little about it and therefore it is getting lesser and lesser audiences. But I also question again in that documentary the future of these forms. But I called it And Miles to Flow on a positive note because I believe in the power of these forms to continue inspiring coming generations. The other thing that I used to do was when I go to countries, perform in countries where English is not the spoken language, I try to explain my pieces in their language, like Arabic or Swiss German or Austrian German or whatever, so that they get a certain understanding of the form while they're watching my performance. Because I was traveling so much and I was moving from country to country, city to city, my dance career was literally in a suitcase that I carried around, and therefore I was never long enough in any place to grow roots. And primarily continued doing solo dancing until one full circle and I come back to base, that is Singapore. And here I found that the cultural landscape had changed drastically. Suddenly there is something called a National Arts Council, which wasn't there before when I left. And they make concerted efforts to promote both traditional as well as contemporary art forms. And another major player that came into the scene is the Esplanade Theatres, who are also presenting all genres of dance from all over the world and also doing consciously working towards audience development. And so here I come again, a place where Kuchipudi is underrepresented. So I get to work on it. And I also thought I should create a new sort of understanding for Kathakali, because to make it more palatable for a lay audience, to give them a certain access to understanding what is being depicted. So there were commissioned works by Esplanade, like Behind the Mask that I did, and Moksha Katha, which is in the clip that you saw, where I took a Kathakali traditional piece, a very celebrated piece called Bodhana Moksham, and but gave it a different treatment without compromising on the artistic integrity of the form. I used a theater actor to carry the narrative forward, and I used a theatrical tool, the aside, to qualify who Krishna is in that production. So that was a part where I could bring in the Kuchipudi and the Bharatanatyam into the production. So finally, the production had three styles in it. Coming to present day issues, especially about the environment, environmental degradation, a subject close to my heart, I created Navodaya. And in that, I used children's theater, which you saw a bit of, because I felt that I wanted that their voices should be heard, because they are the inheritors of this planet. And I used a different soundscape. I used the cello in chunks of solo performance without orchestration, and also the mirava, which is a very traditional revered instrument used in the Kudiyattam, which is the oldest Sanskrit theater. And things like that, many projects like that to bring in audiences, to pique their interest and think that they're not going to watch just one thing, but there will be other things to acquaint them with, you know, other forms or other ideas or other treatments that I have tried to do. And going back to Bombay, I remember when I was commissioned by NESCOM to do a presentation with called Technology and Tradition. Here I used Ikebana, you know, the Japanese flower arrangement form. I used a huge Ikebana arrangement as a metaphor, as well as a prop for that production. And similarly, when I worked with calligraphy, I did the same. In Singapore, fast forward to Singapore again, I thought, because a lot of youth find it not very conducive for them to buy a ticket and come to a theater to watch a show, I thought, why not take it to them, literally? You know, I took it to a cafe. This was a series, an experimental series I did called Mix It Up. We're not dancing about gods and goddesses here. It was just purely experiment with flamenco and Bharatanatyam, Kuchipudi, Western contemporary, with poetry and theater and different soundscapes. But surprise, surprise, the people, the chunk of the people who turned up were middle-aged and senior people. So the question arises, how does one fathom the taste of the audience? And we continue to...
Shall we move into, because it's already 6 o'clock in Malaysia. So shall we start moving into the discussion? And, or is there something else you want to do quickly, round up your part, your segment?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that all of this was pre-pandemic, and now looking at post-pandemic, there are a few things that are, I think, unavoidable or inevitable. One of it is to embrace digital world with much resistance and hesitation and mental barriers. I managed to go past some of these to present my annual dance festival digitally a few months ago, and to recalibrate the way we look at this new ecosystem, and collaborations would be essential. And looking at another thing that I find that I'm grappling with in this new normal is how to choreograph for the camera, how to choreograph for screen. That is something that one needs to understand better, where cinematography and choreography can merge and produce something that can touch the hearts, be more personal to the audiences.
Yes, I mean, Martha Graham said dance is the hidden language of the soul. And I think that's in keeping with what Farooq said. You really have to be vulnerable. You have to open your heart and share that with your audience. And I think a lot of what you said is about reaching younger audiences, because really that's the future. If the young people don't come to dance, then you are losing your audience. And there's a little bit of a discussion going on in the comments section. We have Mark Disney, who's of course always, he's a well-known teacher and deals with young people. And he says, how do you reach younger audiences reared on social media and YouTube who are not too distant from these traditions, especially traditional dance? And we have Yati, who's responded saying, bites use their medium, bite-sized content for Instagram with themes that they understand, not what we want them to know, learn. So maybe I could ask Ramli, you know, how can we reach younger people to make it exciting for them, that's relatable to them? Ramli, you're muted. Ramli, you're muted. You need to unmute.
Yes, I can. No, you are looking at the audience point of view or the dancing point of view? Because the dancing point of view, because I am dealing with the outreach programs, and we have had some really fantastic result in the sense that now almost the major part of my senior dancers are being replaced by the outreach programs from out of cities, Kuala Lumpur dancers, who have been cultivated and groomed now to take over. You know, I mean, that took me about 7 years.
So that's new dancers coming in.
Yes.
But I think this topic is really looking at audiences, to create new audiences. Yeah, so how do we get younger people to come and watch dance, particularly traditional dance?
This is the thing, because the new breed of younger audience, or even younger students, that element of instant gratification is something very difficult for me to comply all the time. So because I'm dealing with serious art, which requires a little bit more than just, okay, what's next? You know, I mean, that I'm just unwilling to be used as just another kind of entertainment segment in their lives. So I do tend not to pander to audience with, like Farooq say, you know, because looking at theatre as a stronger depth of thing. And this is something that is cultivated, because you can have, you cannot compete with Bollywood, or we cannot compete with the kind of K-pops similar types of commercialized words. You cannot compete. But I am interested, and I am interested in keeping the fortress of that. And I'm not looking at a huge big quantity. I'm not going to compete with a stadium trying to do or Bharatanatyam or Odissi, which really the best works that I do is on a small theater where the Abhinaya can be seen. So I think there will always be that, and let me be the person that holds the fort for such a work. And you know, if you want to look, you want to do the K-pop or the kinds of series, go ahead. But
sure.
And this is where the government has, there's a need for government to understand this and not just look at quantity, what they call the KPIs in Kuala Lumpur, the index of success in terms of quantity is really very, very, I think.
Superficial, maybe. Or
not only superficial, it's a death blow to serious art.
Okay. Thank you, Ramli. So quality over quantity. Yes, okay. Ishaan, you want to jump in? Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I did a experimental work with young dancers from 2006, and I stopped before organizing with senior artists because I thought, how do we get this younger generation into the audience? We were getting only 60s and 50s people, you know, coming into all the mamas and mommies coming for the concerts. So how do we get the younger generation? So when we started this youth thing, you know, promoting the younger generation, it that really worked for us. In Pune, we had 3 days of young dancers. Nobody knew anybody in that. They were all really unknown. And some of the sponsors even asked me, who knows these people, who will come? I said, just watch out. You look for it. If it's full, then you might be, you know, you might change your mind, I said. Bharati Vidya Bhavan in Pune, 3 days house full for only young dancers. So it is the right youngsters who bring in their own groups of people to come and see. We have to bring that group in also. And that really works even in Delhi. Today, for young dancers, you get full houses.
And if you have young dancers, then young people come to watch them, yes, watch yes. their peers.
Because so that's their own peers, brilliant. You know, they have absolutely. Their own peers and their followers, and they are more active on social media. One post from a young dancer and there are 50 of them replying to it. So they come to the auditorium to you know, encourage their own friends. And that's how you sort of start getting them also.
That's a fantastic strategy, Usha. Thank you for sharing that. Could I move to Farooq and... I think Usha and Ramli and Shantha are working more in traditional classical Indian dance forms. And Akram Khan and your work is more contemporary, although there's elements of classical, particularly Kathak. How do you get young people to come and see your shows?
Well, as a parent, I've realized if I want change, I have to stop speaking to young people, I have to start listening.
Ah.
And that's where the education begins, you know. I mean, actually, Akram said it just recently in a board meeting that he feels that, you know, despite the fact he feels a little bit detached from the young generation, he feels it's really essential as an artist for them to start listening, maybe invite some young people into our boardroom and have them as part of the conversation. I think it's essential to do that. It doesn't mean, therefore, we have to do what they say, but it's important to listen because in the listening, we'll begin to decode and begin to understand what matters, and that's critical. I mean, I think another thing that's really important is we have to address the issue of a lack of creative education within our schools. You know, in a world that's moving towards technology, towards, you know, functional careers, that diminishing education in schools, creative education in schools is a big factor. And we have to kind of probably press our governments to take more care of that, to ensure that you need a creative nation to appreciate arts. You know, and that's everyone. And just the last thing on that, because one of the ways that we're addressing, and it's not, and after all I said earlier, we're actually doing a version of the Jungle Book next year. Akram is reimagining the Jungle Book. Now, he's not doing it to recreate the Disney version or even the Rudyard Kipling version, because these are rooted in uncomfortable colonial histories. But trying to kind of turn this story on its head and address some of the issues to do with environment, nature, you know, as well as mankind, the kind of, you know, and that's what we've learned, the power of nature to punish us when we start getting too greedy and, you know, and get carried away with our own sense that man is the center of the universe. So I think, and in that we're using ideas of animation, we're integrating some of these new VR technologies. I mean, not for the sake because it's young, but really trying to explore it in a meaningful way that really supports the storytelling and not as a gimmick. So it means that as artists, we have to work harder. We have to expand our direction and rather than be, you know, focused in a very narrow pathway and sit on our success, because a lot of us have been successful. And a dangerous success is complacency. And if we become complacent and if we do not allow those other voices to be heard, we will wilter away and be finished. And, you know, and it's about the art form. It's not about us.
Fantastic. Thank you, Farooq. Really good points, especially listen to young people and to reinvent yourself constantly. And if I could move to a next point that is made by Guide 11, a rather mysterious person called Guide 11. He or she says, if the people won't go to the dance, bring the dance to the people. Temples, corporations, governments could sponsor performances in the temples, parks, palace grounds, and other public spaces. And I would say, you know, in the schools, you know, take the dance into schools, into colleges, and as keep moving on, you know, keeping up with Usha's point, get the students to perform the dance, you know, and that would make it that much more accessible and interesting for the young people. Shantha, perhaps you might.
But that doesn't mean we compromise either with the form, the format, or the caliber. All three have to be there, and then only they can come. They may be young, but that doesn't mean we compromise on any level.
Okay. Yes, absolutely. I mean, because you've got to be consistent with the quality of the work that you're providing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Shantha, perhaps. Some thoughts on you. I know you've taken dance to the people and you found that there were still the older people coming, but any other thoughts about you, about taking dance to the people, to your audience?
Well, I think there are temple festivals happening quite a bit in Singapore. It has been quite a tradition for a while. Is it translating to audiences? I'm not very sure. And Singapore has something called a youth festival that is run in schools where they get competent dance teachers to go and teach dance to students in the school, and then they enter the competition, etc. How much that has translated into audienceship, I do not have the statistics for that. I wish that kind of statistics was easily available to us. But in Singapore, there is a lot of effort that is happening in this direction, I must say.
That's fantastic, because I think that's, you know, the National Arts Council is a huge step that Singapore took, and I think it has
besides the fact that I try consistently to try and reach the youth through all these experimental works and taking it to cafes and still hatching a new plot to do that again when things go back to some kind of normalcy.
Let's hope so. Let's hope that will happen sooner rather than later. Now we have an interesting question by Wei Jun, who's doing the tech for us, and he's a dancer himself. And his question is, video kill the radio star, would it kill the dance star?
Can I jump in there, Chaco?
Yes, please do, yeah. Farouk.
I don't think it's a case of either or. I think what we've discovered this year is that at AKC, we've developed a really beautiful digital program, you know, and understood the nature of that format. You know, you can't have the 1.5 hour thing, the time thing is different. The time, you know, the people's choice, they're much more, you know, when people choose to engage is different. So what we're discovering now is how do we build a bridge between the virtual, the digital content and the physical content? And we start to build a bridge and between the two, because we're discovering on the digital world that actually a younger audience is engaging. They can speak on a one-to-one basis. They can feedback, you know, individually, and we're able to listen to them and have a conversation. So I think one of the ways forward is, you know, as well as look at work that may integrate these elements, but also recognize investment in both these kind of different disciplines, these different platforms, and building a meaningful bridge between them may be a way that we can engage with younger audiences. I don't think the digital is going to kill the physical space, and it's certainly not going to go away, that's for sure.
Yes. So rather than make the digital your enemy, make it your friend.
Yeah.
So now, what about collaborations, you know, with other dance companies, arts companies, filmmakers? Rather than reinventing the wheel, have people done that? You know, rather than so collaborate, like Shantha talked about making a documentary. Now, if you work with a documentary filmmaker, then it could be a win-win situation for you and for that filmmaker. Has any thoughts on that?
It would be like you said, a win-win if we can work marry cinematography and choreography and get somebody with the kind of imagination that is required to deal with dance. Because if you're the choreographer and you get a cinematographer, but somebody has to be a director as well. So all these three people come into the fray. And after that, post-production, the editing is another very, very important part of it. So all of this must come together to be able to create something that, that would probably catch people's imagination.
Absolutely. I think that's film, but any other collaborations that come to mind from our other panelists? Yes, Farooq?
Yeah. I just want to go back to this, my new role as the creative director of China House Arts, how we're looking at collaboration between Chinese artists and Western artists to kind of reimagine and reinvigorate Chinese stories for the kind of contemporary audiences in the contemporary era. And I think that's a really important way forward. I think, you know, cultural collaborations, you know, taking, you know, stories which actually are unknown, because I do believe, and this is something I'm very concerned about, the dominance of the Western canon, aesthetic canon, for so long, right? And that, and these stories are being retold again and again, and people are getting a little bit bored and tired of them. There are an ocean of stories in Asia that need to be told to the world and shared with the world. And this is an opportunity through collaboration to reimagine those stories and to bring them into the contemporary, give them a contemporary relevance so they can have cultural value to all of us.
Okay, and that's part of the heritage of the young people in Asia, for instance, or Asians in UK and other places. That's part of their heritage, and I think they have a right to know and experience that heritage. Yes, Usha, you were wanting to say something.
Yeah, I just want to give an example of what is happening in Moscow currently when I work here. Since India has been coming here, performing Indian dancers have been coming, we've had festivals of India, so they appreciate us. But the fact that we also appreciate them is something that they are very keen to understand. So that's why these collaborations work very well for us. So if we take a ballet dancer and a Indian dancer and then try and create something, or their music and our music, they are very happy with it. The Tchaikovsky Conservatory, for example, they would love to work with Amjad Ali Khan Saab. They're all very keen about that. Recently, I just played a small clip for them from an Odissi dancer of India, Sharmila Mukherjee, who'd done a production on Hansika, which is on Swan Lake. The music was recreated by, you know, well-known music director called Praveen D. Rao, but using all the Indian instruments, but the same music of Tchaikovsky. So I just played it to them just for them to hear. And the government, the Ministry of Culture representatives, when they heard the sitar playing the same melody, they were so excited that now they would like to do a joint venture on Swan Lake with us. So
fantastic.
So this collaboration in terms of actually bringing it closer to each other and trying to see where the bridges can be drawn, as, you know, Farooq Bhai and all of them have been doing in the past, across other genres, is something that classical has to also start approaching very consciously. While you may not, I mean, the classicists are so traditional that they don't want to even move from their their jatis and their adavas, but I still feel that there is a way that you can actually bring both of this together, and this is what is Maitri about, this is what is friendship about, and this is what is Vasudeva Kutumbukam, the world is one large family. So we have this philosophy, but how much are we moving towards that? Something that I think even the traditionalists should start thinking about.
Yes, I think fusion is the in thing in terms of food and clothes and so on. Yes, Farooq, you were...
Yeah, I would challenge that, Chaco. I think fusion is dangerous. What it does, it brings pre-existing ideas together in a fixed space. Okay. I think the future collaborations rely on us being empty,
more flowing.
Abandoning our cultural memory, not in the bad sense of the word, and going into a collaborative relationship almost empty to create something new together, recognizing that someone has something different from ourselves. And by when we get into that empty space, we'll be able to find something new. I think when we come in too much with our cultural baggage, it almost sometimes it cancels each other out. And so you get a kind of clunky kind of coming together of different perspectives. And so therefore we need to move at for that to succeed, we need trust, and a different kind of trust. Not the trust of old where, it's transactional trust. It's the trust to know that I can be vulnerable with you, working with you. I don't really know, I'm prepared to learn, and I'm also prepared to move at the speed of trust to allow something new to be created.
So it's give and take, and in an environment of trust. Well, we're coming, you know, we've actually gone past the time that we'd allocated to ourselves, and I'm sure our viewers, and I'm sure many of you have things to move on to. So Farooq, I think we, you know, that's a fantastic point to sort of round up your part of the segment. Can I invite maybe Ramli to say last few thoughts on this topic of creating new audiences for dance?
Well, I think the work on the virtual area requires what Farooq did mention, or Shantha did mention. It's a different paradigm shift altogether. Perhaps this is the time when the choreographer is no longer is fully artistically responsible for the work, because then there are so many other inputs from the visual director, the camera person, and all those kind of things. And this is the frightening things for the choreographer, I guess, or the artistic director of the theater, or the director. And I think this is the kind of collaboration that we're talking, the eventual collaboration, if we want to get into this other areas where the theater experience, the dance theater experience is prominent. I think now anything goes for me, as long as it is good and the standard is high. I think the integrity of the work is first and foremost, of course, the passion, the knowledge and all that, but basically the integrity. And eventually, for people like myself in Malaysia, there has been such a disconnect between the practitioner, the dancers, the scholars, and the bureaucrats themselves, that there must be a working together for all the three to come out where the work itself, and this is where I think that we are all lesser than the cause, which is the art, the dance, the theater, the music. And this is where we all have to have the integrity to make it happen. And one of the major things, say for Malaysian, is the funding and to recognize, you know, so not just in dance, in theater, in blah, 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 in many, many other areas, in the Orang Asli or the indigenous people. And I think, let's bring in the true expert and people with passion and integrity of their own section to have a kind of a control of where the message of the work will come through the people and the young people, you know, and not live it in the same political kind of people with such agendas.
And, so take politics, take the national politics out of the arts, and let the arts flourish on their own.
And of course, Chaco, as you all know, one of the killing aspect is the rise of extremist ideas, not dogmatic ideas that come, say, for example, in fundamentalist Islam, that has literally, culturally, has the effect of genociding the Malay culture in Malaysia.
Okay, that's a whole new forum, probably a series forum.
And it does affect.
Thank you, Ramli. Yeah, I think we're sort of fast running out of time. And may I compliment you on your etches. I know there's beautiful sketches behind you, are your work. So obviously you're multi-talented, not just a dancer, choreographer, also a beautiful artist, fine artist. And Usha, if you would like to have some last words, and I know those are your sketches behind you as well, right, Usha?
We are so narcissistic.
Why Sorry. Not? It's beautiful.
No, I just felt that these are, you know, beautiful head jewelry, and it worked for dance, so I just put them back there.
But so that's your artwork, right?
Yes.
Yes. You want to just tilt your screen a little bit so we can see it properly for 1 minute? Oh, yes. Oh, wonderful. Yeah. Headdresses for Indian dancers. Okay, Usha, just a quick final words to our viewers on this topic of creating.
You know, I think that for the younger generation and newer audiences to come in, there has to be a kind of sensitivization that we are talking about. One should try to package or to communicate tradition not in the manner in which somebody should get put off, but in a manner that they should be able to appreciate it. When Nirbhaya happened and this entire episode about gender sensitivization happened on male gender in India, I said Tyagaraja had written in the 17th century. In Telugu, he says, Yavaraina lera peddalu, aren't there any elders in this village who can guide and sensitivize the young boys not to stand in the corners of the streets and tease women? This is the song that he wrote in the 17th century. Goodness. I don't think we need to sensitize our audiences, younger generation, that there is so much to even talk through tradition without trying to make it look very ancient and fuddy-duddy and all that. So there has to be a manner of it. And I think sensitivizing younger generation and the pride that it should bring on what we have, on what we are, what our arts are, I think that is very important. You come out of that, this is the first time Ramli was just talking about bureaucracy and all this politics. And this is the first time that a non-foreign service officer, the person is sitting in the post of a director for Jawaharlal Cultural Center. And so across the world, even in London, you have Amish Tripathi. You have different people across the globe. The 36 centers have mostly people who are not from foreign service. So I think that's a very welcome change. We've got a person, I remember Sushma Swarajji, the minister, saying that aapka jo nritya aur sangeet ka prem hai, wo Moscow mein bahut rang laega. She said, your love for dance and music is going to really bring big results in Moscow. And I think that was what she wanted. She wanted people from the arts to come and head these situations, these institutions, so that we can do more for artists, more for the art than just move files,
And more for the audience. Yes, absolutely. So, thank you, Usha.
Thank you so much for this opportunity once again.
And that was lovely insights, and I do hope that things go back to normal for you and you can continue sharing your art with the audiences of Russia. And finally, Shantha, some final words. This is your forum. Any final words to our viewers? We're coming close to 6:30.
Well, like what Farooq just said, we must try to listen to the younger people. Listening is very important. And I tried to do this before I did that series in the cafes, but probably not enough. To listen to them and see what is it that they find difficult to relate to in what we present. And take it from there, not to compromise on what we do, but take it from there and slowly kind of appeal to their senses and with a certain relevance. Topics that are relevant is very important because a lot of them say, oh, you people dance about mythology and this and that. I'm really not so interested. Okay, relevance is important. We accept that, and that is valid to bring in social issues that we face today in this world, in this present world, is also important. It's not that these issues are not there in the traditional work. It is there, but we can also create new work if we want to. But in creating too, we have to be careful because the audio sensibilities of people, they like something that they are familiar with. Familiarity is very important. But if you bring something, maybe a marvelous composition that I've newly got composed for myself, it may not be as appealing as something that is already existing, if I can take it and work through that. That would mean, a little more entry point to the people to come in to appreciate the art. And of course, like everybody agree here, that the art is so much bigger than all of us. We are little messengers trying to bring this art and keep it going in however manner, whichever manner is possible in our respective places. And there are different cultural sensibilities as well that we need to take into consideration, and the sensibilities of these young people that we are wanting to bring into the fold, which is very, very important. And that collective consciousness, I hope, would work for us. To become aware of this and work towards it. And maybe I'd like to bring a Rumi's quote here, Jalaluddin Rumi, who said, "What we seek is seeking us." So if that be true, I hope it is slowly nudging us in the right direction.
Absolutely. Thank you, Shantha. And it's 6:30, and I think we should close the session. I think it's been a wonderful dialogue and discussion, some amazing insights on this important topic of creating new audiences for dance. Suffice for me to say thank you to our panelists, to Padma Shri Dato Ramli Ibrahim, to Usha RK all the way from Moscow, Farooq Chowdhury, OBE, and of course, the lady behind all this, Shantha Ratii. And a quick thank you to Wei Jun, who's been making us all look and sound good. Wei Jun, do you want to come on and say hello to everybody?
Hello, everybody. I'm here.
Wei Jun's looking very festive with your balloons there. And I think what I've been hearing is, you know, we need to innovate. We need to target young people. We need to listen to them. We need to collaborate, but collaborate, come in empty, without preconceived ideas or without baggage, but maintaining the integrity and quality of our work, and get young people to dance, and then young people will come and watch dance. And with that, I say once again, I'm Chako Vadaketh. Thank you to all our viewers for tuning in and joining us. This will be it is being recorded and it'll be uploaded. So if you want to share that with other people, we would be delighted for you to do so. Thank you, everybody. Good morning to London, good afternoon to Moscow, and good evening to Kuala Lumpur and Singapore. Have a wonderful day. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Thank you.
Thank you.